responsibility for it.
It's been 3 years now since you fell ill with GBS, right?
Right.
Has the federal government, in your estimation, played fair with you about your claim?
No, I don't think so. It seems to be dragging on and on and on, and really, no end in sight that I can see at this point.
With respect to the cases of Guillaume Barre, allegedly...
Former Secretary of HEW Joseph Califano, too, was disturbed that there was no end in sight. So a year and a half ago, he promised that Uncle Sam would cut the bureaucratic red tape for victims suffering from GBS and would pay up quickly.
We shouldn't hold them to an impossible or too difficult standard of proving that they were hurt. Even if we pay a few people a few thousand dollars that might not have deserved it, I think justice requires that we promptly pay those people who do deserve it.
Who's making the decision to be so hard-nosed about settling?
Well, I assume the Justice Department is.
Griffin Bell, before he left?
Well, the Justice Department agreed to the statement I made. It was cleared word for word with the lawyers in the Justice Department by my HEW lawyers.
And that statement said, in effect...
That statement said that we should pay Guillaume Barre claims without regard to whether the federal government was negligent if they resulted from the swine flu shot.
I think the government knows it's wrong.
If it drags out long enough, that people will just give up. Let it go.
I am a little more adamant in my thoughts than my wife is, because I told Judy to take the shot. She wasn't going to take it, and she never had shots, and I'm mad with my government because they knew the facts, but they didn't release those facts because if they had released them, the people wouldn't have taken. And they can come out tomorrow and tell me there's going to be an epidemic, and they can drop off like flies next to me. I will not take another shot that my government tells me to take.
Meantime, Judy Roberts and some 4,000 others like her are still waiting for their day in court.
I don't need another flu shot. I had a flu shot last year.
A swine flu epidemic may be coming.
Swine flu shot? Well, I don't know. I've been thinking about it.
It could make you very sick.
Swine flu? Man, I'm too fast for them to catch me.
You'll want to be protected.
I'm the healthiest 55-year-old you've ever seen. Hey, I play golf every weekend.
Get a shot of protection. The swine flu shot.
Joe brought it home from the office. He gave it to Betty and one of his kids and to Betty's mother. But Betty's mother went back to California the next day. On her way to the airport, she gave it to a cab driver, a ticket agent, and one of the charming stewardesses. At school, Joe's kid gave it to some other kids, and Mrs. Merrill got it and gave it to her husband. In California, Betty's mother gave it to her best friend, Dottie. But Dottie had a heart condition and she died. But before she died, Dottie gave it to her girlfriend, the mailman, the paper boy, and the vet when she went to pick up her chihuahua.
If a swine flu epidemic comes, this is how it could spread. You'll want to be protected, especially if you're elderly or chronically ill. Get a shot of protection. The swine flu shot.
Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the second edition of Build and Destroy. Well, my hope is to build up our community and destroy the myths that come along with us and the myth that we are innately self-destructive and any other negativity that surrounds our community. If you've ever listened to me on air, you already understand that I know that there are bad seeds in the community. But it's time for us to ignore those bad seeds, so to speak, and put ourselves in a position of power. So I've taken time out of my day. It's going to be each Saturday to make sure we are not suffering from the propaganda. What you just previously heard was an excerpt from 60 Minutes. And if you paid any attention to it, and if you didn't hear it in its entirety, please go back once the show is over and listen to the very beginning of it, so you can see the parallels between the 60-minute piece in 1977 and what you're hearing every day on the news. It opens two doors, if you ask me. The first door it opens is the fact that people my age, which is 50, or just go with this, people who were born from like 1977 back to the beginning of time, we were conditioned to trust the news because the news was offering us what we perceived as the truth. They used to be called the third estate. They were not the people, they were not the government, but they were standing up for the people. That's why, I mean, if you wonder, why did you even believe them? It's because of programs like 60 Minutes and others that used to stand up and present what we thought was a defense between the propaganda machines and the government and people who took advantage of the people. They were showing you the light. And it looks like the media is no longer that. It looks like they are part of the machine. They're part of the propaganda. And they put us in jeopardy and in peril at every turn. That's what it seems like at this point. You have terms like fake news and things of that nature. And it also opens the door and sheds light on what's going on right now. It was eerily, when I heard this report, it was eerily similar to exactly what we're hearing every day on the news. Even up to the very end of it, when you heard, if you're healthy, you're going to pass it along by Ticketmaster and all, you know, any feasible way you can get it. The way they're telling us about this whole COVID-19 thing, it's the exact same thing. So I want everybody to take care of themselves. I want everybody to stay, keep your common areas clean. And I want everybody to just take a little bit of stress out of your life. That's the reason I put that at the top of the show. Because stress is also a leader to you and your immune system being weak. Because if you are stressing, you're not resting, you're not eating properly, you're putting your life in danger. Every day, whether it be COVID, whether it be swine flu, whether it be Ebola, or whether it be a common cold. So with that being said, allow me to start my show, but you know how I start every show. I send out respect to each and every ancestor that I have, because it's taught to me, if you send respect and blessings to the ancestors, they send down protection and blessings to you. So just respect everybody in the Whitmore family, the Pollard family, the Turner family, the Battle family, the Cotton family, the Auburn family, the Bailey family, the Chris family, the Lansdowne family, the Higgins family, the Duncan's family, and me, my parents, my sisters and my brothers, we are part of the Williams section of my family. I'd like to thank you for tuning in. This is HRAP B. And again, it's called Building Show. Thank you, everybody who's listening, and everybody who we consider here good for this network background listeners. It's not a slight. It's just you're not active in the chat room, and I can't interact with you and get comfortable that way. If you want to be a part of the active chat room, you can either add your email, create a profile. You can connect to our network via social media. You can use your Facebook and or your Twitter accounts to create your profile. It creates automatically, and then you move forward. While I have your attention, full attention, or hopefully I'll keep your full attention, while I have it though, what I want you guys to do is this. Hit the like button, and if you're not subscribed to the network, please do as well. It helps us continue to grow, helps us recruit sponsorship, and basically makes us look. Now, it is like I said, man, this whole medical situation that we're going through, It has knocked people down to their socks. The financial world is being crippled. The healthcare world is being questioned. People are losing their jobs like 40 going north. And no one seems to have an answer. And don't even assume that I have an answer. Because I'm not going to lie to you and say I do. You know, it's I don't even have a clue what to do next. But what I do understand is this. As church people say, as spiritual people say, as religious people say, or whatever category you fall into, this too will pass. And when it passes, that's why I'm on today. To discuss what happens when this passes. At the end of the day, we saw something similar in 2008. The market crashed. We were losing, the United States of America was losing 22,000 jobs per day. Everybody was scared that the world financially was ending. We didn't know what to do, right? So, at that time, I told anybody who would listen to me, it's a race to stand up. The entire world is laying on its back. The entire world is suffering. So it is your opportunity as a citizen of the world and a citizen of our community to stand up, the person who stands up first to potentially be king or queen. I feel the exact same way with this COVID-19. When you are part of an oppressed community, you're pretty much laying flat on your back. You're suffering like no other's been suffering. And at this point, I personally believe it is a form of oppression. Here's an opportunity for us to galvanize our community and fight against any and every enemy that's available. Whether it be interpersonal enemies that don't want our community to stand up, that people who are part of our community, or people who are outside of our community who's attacking our community and putting our community in peril. But at the end of the day, it's time for us to stand up. Stand together and move forward. I was talking to a friend, a real good friend, and we were talking about things that we can do. Now, these are not solutions, these are suggestions. You are welcome to disagree, and I don't have a problem with anyone disagreeing. This is just open dialogue and possible ways to resolve these things. I don't need anybody. You know, it's going to sound ridiculously arrogant, what I'm about to say, but I don't need anybody to agree with me. I really don't. I appreciate that you listen, but you don't have to agree. And that's the first thing I'm going to attack that's going on in our community. The people that I've communicated with over the last 49 some odd years, we, in a lot of times, believe that just because something is a good idea, and I can go on and you can go on and make riches, everybody needs to get behind it. But we don't. Now, I can support you mentally. I can support you in a way in which it will uplift you and not join you in your mission. Because it's not that I don't appreciate your mission, or I don't understand your mission, or I even don't even agree with it. It may not be for me. Most times this line of thinking shows up when we're talking about spirituality or religion. If you're not a Christian, you're wrong. You're going to hell. If you're not a Muslim, you're going to hell. If you're not a Jehovah's Witness, you're going to hell. Or whatever. If you don't agree or believe in what I believe in, you are in peril. What you've officially, unofficially done is create a wall between you and your friend, neighbor, cousin, or what have you. It's not going to work. And it's time for us to stop doing that. I don't have to agree with you. I don't have to be a part of your line of thinking. I don't have to do anything in order to support you. It just may not be my time. If you have a great plan, like with this network, I offered partnership before I even considered doing it this way to a bunch of my friends and family members. Nobody took me up on it. Those same people listen all the time. And I respect and appreciate each and every one of them. It wasn't a slight against me. It wasn't all.